Welcome to another episode of Reboot with Dr. Arasi Maran. I have a fantastic and a very fabulous guest here, Dr. Jonathan Fisher. Dr. Jonathan Fisher is not only a practicing cardiologist for over 20 years, but has recently come out with a book called Just One Heart. That book is truly an enlightening exploration of the intricate connection between the emotional and the physical heart health. He blends his expertise as a cardiologist with a holistic understanding of the human experience, presenting the heart not just an organ or a pump, but as a core of our emotional life. The book truly emphasizes the importance of living a heart-centered life and is both a physical guide and an emotional guide. And he highlights the connection that the heart is impacted by love, fear, isolation, social connections, and what we can do to make it better. And the book, you know, has so many personal stories, patient experiences, scientific researchers. I'm so glad you accepted my invitation and you're here to have this discussion with us, Jonathan. Thank you so much and welcome to the show.
I love speaking with other cardiologists. So when you reached out, this is my mission, is that if we can't start to embrace a different view of the heart beyond just a mechanical pump, how can we expect the rest of the world? So I'm really excited.
Absolutely. So the first question is going to be, tell us your journey. How did you go from a cardiologist to a kind of a healer in a more holistic format?
I needed to do work on myself, and is so often the case, I was forced to. I almost was forced to leave my practice as a cardiologist more than a dozen years ago because I had so many emotional and psychological stresses that were building up over time, and I had very little self-awareness. What I was really good at, and I know that this is true for you and so many doctors, is focusing for long periods of time, gathering and amassing a tremendous amount of information, committing to helping other people, even sacrificing our own health, our own well-being, our own families in the process. And unfortunately or fortunately, that led me to a very dark place where I was going to work seeing 24 patients a day, 3,000 patients a year, and I was helping them to some degree, but looking deeper, if someone asked me how I was doing, I was crying on the inside, miserable, for years. And there was no choice but to look for some solutions that would help me heal my own heart, as it was, not just the physical, but I realized that we speak about the heart as if it's a metaphor, that our emotions metaphorically come from the heart. But the more I saw my own experience as a doctor trying to help others, the more I listened to my patients, I realized that the work was not just on exercise and nutrition and blood pressure and my own cholesterol, but I had to do some deeper work. And what I came to discover were the four dimensions of the heart.
Fabulous. I think, you know, all of us are extremely guilty. And right now I'm wearing so many different hats. And over the years, I've realized if I reach out to a soda, then that's a cry for help. It's a coping mechanism. And it might seem simple, but I'm looking for a quick dopamine hit somewhere. And I think, you know, I'm glad you were able to go on this journey. And I think I was in a similar spot maybe, it's much longer, 8 years ago or something like that. And the way then I got myself a coach to help me process this. And she particularly liked the way I described what I felt. And I said, I feel like a live wire, always burning. And somebody just touches me and I just like shock the heck out of them or something like that. And I had to learn how to do that.
Arasi, the more you notice you share your own story, the more of our colleagues and other doctors are saying, oh, I thought I was the only one that's a live wire. For you, it was a live wire. For me, it was more like a mousetrap. Like I was just lying very still. But if you came at me the wrong way, whether it was a patient who I thought was being frustrating or a colleague who I thought was saying things or even in my own family, you better watch out because I would snap. And I didn't like the person that I was showing up as for all these other people, which was exhausted, frustrated, angry, and not kind at all, which was the opposite of what I wanted to be.
And, you know, I think there's also a little bit of a difference in every patient, every person's response. I saved my best for work, my patients, my workplace. I would never lose my temper, you know, and at home, oh my God, nobody dare come near me. So it's, you know, and I'm so glad there's so much awareness, or at least people like you and in my own space, we are voicing this out that we don't need to suffer alone and we should get the help we need or introspect our lives better.
Yeah, absolutely. And help comes in many forms. What I'm finding as I'm committing the second half of my career, not just caring for patients, but seeing how we can look at the broken healthcare system and how so many of our colleagues, more than 50%, are burning out and disengaging. And also thinking about their families, like you described, not just they're getting a worse patient care, but their families are getting the worst parts of us if we don't fix something in our system. So as I'm doing this, my main message is we often believe it's not okay to ask for help. I'm the head of the cath lab. I'm the head of the echo lab. I'm the head of the clinic. And so I don't need anybody's help. I can do it myself. And I think it's unfortunate that that's the opposite message of what we need to be sharing right now. The old way of doing things in healthcare does not help us, doesn't help our patients or our families. And there's so much help available as we work to restructure the systemic problems that are creating the burnout in the first place.
Absolutely. I mean, I couldn't agree with you more. I think you're, it's just so spot on that I'm speechless a little bit. All right, let's go to your book. I thoroughly enjoyed reading your book and thank you so much for sending me a signed copy. It's fabulous. And I've actually bought some of it and gifted it to my colleagues as well, especially the people I think should read it for the reasons we mentioned before. Thank you. So can you explain the concept of heart wisdom as you discussed in your book? What do you refer to as heart wisdom?
We are taught that wisdom exists in the left side of the cerebral cortex in our Western society. Now, I don't want to lump everything in together. In the West, there was a time when we believed in deeper wisdom, when there was a wisdom of the spirit, of the soul, of the psyche, of the body. But there's been a divergence over the last 1,000 years where wisdom, as science has emerged, has located it in one very small place of the human brain. And this goes against 3,000 years of human philosophy and all of the wisdom traditions, which say that the body itself holds something deeper than the intellect, that the mind is not located in one small part of the brain. The mind actually comes from sensations in the body, sensations in the heart, and the way we evolved, the way the heart evolved, is not simply to pump blood to the aorta. That's not its only purpose. There are feedback mechanisms between the vagus nerve and the cerebral cortex and the midbrain, which are constantly giving us information beneath the level of consciousness that are helping us make decisions. And what I'm encouraging people to start thinking about is tapping into the wisdom of the heart, which sometimes means just slowing down, listening, checking in with the body. Some people would call it a gut sensation, but we also know that when we're either stressed or when we're feeling in flow, the heart can send sensory information to the brain. I'm just encouraging people to tap into that. And also it has to do with emotional intelligence.
When you talk about sensations, can you name a few? Is it like, obviously it's not the same for everyone, but can you give me an example of what they would be?
Yeah, there's been wonderful research done about 5 years ago in Finland, looking at what's called an emotional map of the body. And the question the researchers had was, is there any consistent sensation that you or I might have, even though we've never met in person, that if we both get scared, let's say, we have fear, is there anything in common other than our description, our subjective experience? And they looked at populations around the world. And they caused them to experience a variety of different emotions. happiness, joy, love, anger, pride, fear, disgust. And they had the participants create a visual map of their own body, where they were feeling during those emotions, areas of contraction, areas of quickening, of slowing, of lightening, of warmth, of coolness. And what they discovered is that the most common emotions have very specific maps of the body that are consistent across cultures. And so we know that, for example, now coming back to the heart, that when we feel fear or we have activation of the adrenergic system from fight or flight, there's a increasing in the heart rate. There's an increase in the force of contraction. We can feel. Some people call it a palpitation or a tightness or a contraction. On the flip side, emotions that are more uplifting, some people call positive emotions, whether it's generosity, optimism, gratitude, joy, kindness, and love, there is the opposite. There's an expansive sensation in the chest. There's often a feeling of warmth, a flushed sensation, a relaxing. So our challenge is, if we want to become more aware of how to manage our stress and to live with more joy and more positive emotions, to start noticing the information that's already coming from our body instead of distracting ourselves when we feel uncomfortable with the phone or behaving in certain ways. It's returning to the awareness of the body, which is already designed to help us make better decisions.
And how does that look like? I mean, you know, we are in such a go, go, go world. The 20-year-olds are stressed out. The 20-year-olds are pumping themselves with energy drinks and Red Bulls and Monsters and, you know, and coffee. How do they even do that?
Yeah. The energy drink industry is a multi-billion dollar industry exactly for the reason that you're saying. We're living in an attention deficit culture right now. And the most famous book right now is called The Anxious Generation by Jonathan Haidt, explaining the crisis that our teens are facing. And I have three teenagers. The question of how, and I love this answer, the question of how is always yes. In other words, let's not assume that it's impossible to return to a more calm, balanced state. Let's assume instead that no matter how hard it might be for us right now, there is a way to restore our sense of calm and ease and connection in our lives. In my own experience and the people that I've worked with, thousands of leaders now, it goes back to some very old, now evidence-based practices around mindfulness and around compassion. And what that means is we have so much information flooding our nervous system every second. If you're in the cath lab, you have more than 11 bits of information every second coming from the screen, coming from the patient, coming from all five senses, and coming from inside of you. So the only solution, Arasi, to returning and restoring a state of calm where this natural empathy and connection emerges is to slow down, is to practice becoming aware of all the bits of information and our own reaction to them, and retraining our minds and our hearts to become less reactive as the information comes in, and to make fewer assumptions, to create fewer stories. That's a very broad description of the practice of mindfulness, which is simply practicing slowing down and becoming aware of what's happening without judging it like we normally like to do.
That's, you know, I was one of, when I first started in medicine, I was completely against mindfulness practice, or if they say meditation or mindfulness, I would be like, this is so woo-woo. Don't you bug me with this. You know, truly, I mean, despite coming from like an Indian culture, I was a Bharatanatyam dancer, and they tried to teach us a lot, but I was very resistant to change, okay? But having said that, cath lab specifically and emotional experiences in the cath lab, I have definitely, I prefer the term mindfulness practice than any other religious connotation to it. And I definitely understand what you're talking about, but it was hard and it required a lot of intention from my, I wanted to do it and therefore I did it. And I have two teenagers. I'm trying my best to tell them, and they are worse than me. I mean, my husband says they are your children. What do you expect? It is. So So there's so much resistance to change. Forget the teenagers, they are a different being. Even the young adults or even people in our age, because I want to know, how can we expand our resilience? How can we improve our resilience so that we can actually face this? Are there ways to improve your resilience?
Yeah, there's a couple pieces there, Rasi, that you referred to. The first is really worth pausing on, which is you use the word change and resistance to change. Part of the way we evolved is that we have to develop patterns of behavior. Again, 11 million bits of information. We can't be always having to analyze how to put our shoes on in the morning. So we develop this automatic way of existing, which often leads us to say things and to answer and to respond in very reactive ways without even being intentional anymore. And if we're looking at the problem of disconnection and distraction and disengagement, and you ask, how do we change? How do we change ourselves and others? I think there's only two reasons any of us change, and you know this from your patients. They change because of something they're afraid of that already happened or is going to happen, like they had a heart attack and they're on your table, and now they're saying, how can I quit smoking? Or they see something that is potentially much better for them, a vision of a future that maybe somebody else is enjoying a trip with their family, and they're climbing a mountain and they're wishing they could have that. So I think it comes back to this basic human motivation. There's either fear or desire. And going against that is this other human drive towards comfort and avoiding change. So I wanted to call that out since you mentioned it. In terms of where do we start? Like any change, we start with asking someone. So I tried early on to teach my children how to meditate, and I even wanted to tell my wife about all these great things. And I learned something very quickly that a lot of people in this space are learning, which is, don't try to tell someone else what to do. People don't like that. People don't like that. We have to respect everyone's autonomy and respect the fact that we're all in our own place in this journey, and we never try to force anything on anyone, but we can always be a good coach. And you had, it sounds like, a great coach, and I'm sure your coach asked you sensitive and empathic questions. They didn't try to make you do anything. And so where I begin with my patients, and I do meditate with my patients at the end of each visit, it's a 15-minute visit. 7 or 8 minutes is spent on the EMR, on the computer. 7 minutes, I try to make eye contact. I do a little better because I've been practicing communication skills for 10 years now and trying to really bring empathy into every visit. So I usually have 1 or 2 minutes at the end of the visit where I ask the patient that I'm with, I notice you're feeling a lot of stress. I notice that you told me anxiety is causing heart palpitations and chest pain and making it hard for you to make good dietary choices. Would you like to try something that is safe, free, and doesn't take much time? And you can imagine with that kind of an invitation, patients say yes. And so we sit for a minute or two. It's not complicated. We simply bring awareness to our racing mind. We give ourselves permission to be together, to be still, to do this practice together in this crazy, chaotic healthcare system, to just become aware of our bodies sitting, of our breath moving in and out, and of any thoughts and feelings as they arise, and any judgments, and try to together come to a place of non-judgment, of calm and connection between the two of us. And now, Rasi, I have patients coming back for follow-up visits way too soon because they just want to do this practice with me.
Yes, absolutely. I think, this is a term, I open blood vessels which are chronically occluded, chronic total occlusions. And when I went to get trained for it, there was a statement which they made, and I found that statement spoke to me in multiple different levels, as a mother, as a wife, as a doctor, and when I lose a patient, as a patient. And the statement they said was, get comfortable being uncomfortable. And that honestly was like, oh yeah, they taught us, because we had to intentionally dissect blood vessels, which is a very uncomfortable thing to do, and then we re-enter the vessel, etc. But I was like, that's such a That statement blew my mind, because that's what I think we all resist. We resist discomfort or uncomfortableness in different ways. And I think that's what you are talking about too. Am I coming along the same path here?
Yeah. So much of the what we call maladaptive behaviors that we see in our patients, and also I do it myself, and you even made reference to it yourself when reaching towards a soda. If we look carefully when we're reaching for the soda, or in my case, when I'm reaching for the chocolate chip ice cream, or I'm scrolling on social media, if I really pause and I ask myself, why am I doing this now? It's often to escape or avoid discomfort, some emotional issue that I don't want to face, I don't want to look at, or it's a way of numbing myself so I don't have to feel so much, because I don't want to think about the patient of mine who died last week. I don't want to think about going into a 4-day call with no breaks. I don't want to think about those. So the practice of mindfulness, of non-judgmental awareness, is also called the practice of equanimity. And the best cath attending, the one that I want to open my chronic occlusion, is not the one that gets excited and yelling and throwing the wires across the table and screaming at people. The one that I want, is the one that has practiced in every situation, noticing the thoughts that come up when something goes wrong. And is it a thought of criticism and harshness, or is it a thought of, I can make it through this, we are a team, I'm going to be compassionate for myself, I'm doing the best I can in this moment with the tools that I have. And no matter what happens, it's going to be a learning experience for my benefit and the benefit of others. It's a radically different approach to discomfort. And you hit on something really essential, which is, if we all were a little more comfortable with our own discomfort, I think we'd see a lot less illness in the world.
You know, obesity, as you know, has just become a big epidemic. And we are coming with so many interventions, medical, therapeutic interventions, surgical interventions, etc. But I keep going back, why are we not asking the biggest question, which is, how did we get here? And we got here, like what you said, we keep trying to mask our issues with food, chocolate chip ice cream for you, or soda, or definitely chocolate for me, or, you know, and if left uncontrolled, you know, we would be walking around with whatever our poison is all the time, because, and I feel maybe the system, because mental health talks or mental health interventions is not lucrative. It doesn't make any system money. And I feel we are ignoring this problem. And it, you know, when you talk about systemic change and changing the system, I just feel like we are ignoring this and fighting this problem like a whack-a-mole. Like we are just trying to hit each thing which pops, but we are not going to the root of the problem, which is mental health issues. What is your take?
650 million people around the world are obese today. And since 1975, that number has tripled. And what you're hitting on is there are deeper causes that we have to address as we are using these new medications to lose weight and the surgical procedures. And unless we shift the conversation towards prevention and getting comfortable with what I look at are the four dimensions of the heart, which intersect and are interdependent, We will never reverse the obesity epidemic and the associated diabetes epidemic, with 530 million people around the world with diabetes, which is between the two, and physical inactivity, which is happening more for a variety of reasons. We will only become sicker as a world population, and the public health crisis and expense are going to increase. When I look for the roots of this crisis, as a cardiologist, I naturally thought about the heart. Now, yes, there's the physical dimension, and we have to look at the pillars of lifestyle medicine. We have to look at the big eight from the American Heart Association. Yes, we have to focus on those. But we also have to look at three other dimensions of the human heart, which are driving this crisis. There's the emotional dimension, which you alluded to when you said mental health. I think a lot of what we call mental health is actually emotional health, and it has to do with anxiety, depression, loneliness, and unaddressed post-traumatic issues. The third dimension of the heart, as Vivek Murthy, the Surgeon General, pointed out last year, is a crisis of loneliness and social isolation affecting 25 to 35% of all Americans, which has dramatically increased, more than fivefold in the last 50 years. And we know that there's a cardiovascular risk with loneliness and social isolation. There's a suicide risk, a drug abuse risk. And then the fourth dimension of the heart, which I think is deeper than all of these, is the spiritual dimension of the heart. And I don't mean spiritual in some kind of a woo-woo mystical sense that where we're talking about some religion or another. I'm simply talking about that deep human longing to connect with something much bigger than our day-to-day of where am I going to have dinner tonight and what's on TV. A connection with a deeper sense of meaning and a larger sense of purpose beyond ourselves. So my focus and the reason I wrote the book is to expand our conversation around the heart so that we can address the crisis that's happening in all four of these dimensions.
You know, it's fantastic that I think it's almost like society is at, it's fighting within itself. Every company wants profit, profit, profit. They want the graph to go, keep going up. And then I'm like, if you're going to keep going up, the human input, the human, the pressure on the workers is going to be so much more and more and more. There is no sense of satiation with regards to everything. We just want more of this and more of that and more productivity. And on top of it, more mental health, more this. I'm like, you know, we are kind of fighting with, we are just hitting ourselves in the face and also healing, trying to heal ourselves at the same time. And I honestly, I'm not going to say I have an answer for it, but I think overall, we as a society have to say enough. I'm happy with my company's growth and it's okay. Let my workers just be where they are and let's focus on mental health and a value proposition in a different way than just keep chasing the numbers. And, you know, it's I don't know how every company can be profitable all the time. And anytime, like the Starbucks CEO, Starbucks had a dip and they fired him and they got a new CEO. And like, is that really the right way? Isn't Starbucks profitable enough at the expense of everyone else's health in the form of the sugary drinks? You know,
I speak specifically about the need for organizational reform and the conflict between the capitalist model and human flourishing and well-being, because there is some tension that's always going to be there. And I speak a bit about the crisis of burnout across all sectors and industries. And I do a lot of speaking, not just within healthcare, but, you know, for law association and the tech industry, et cetera, and banking. And it comes back to what you're describing, which is it's time for us to redefine the word profit. What does it mean to profit? We have to redefine what is the bottom line. Can it only be dollars, or is it about human flourishing and sustainable human health? And I'm happy to see that there is a wave. And chapter 13 is, I've interviewed a dozen leaders across the world who are leading in a different way, where their bottom line has to do more with these intangible elements of human well-being and human flourishing. And contrary to what some people might think is that if we spend more time on well-being and mental health, we're going to lose our competitive edge. We're going to lose our profits. Well, what we know, and this comes from the chief medical officer of Cooper University, Stephen Ciziak, who is an ICU intensivist, and he wrote an important book called Compassionomics. And in his book, he lays out hundreds of citations showing that organizations and businesses who prioritize human well-being over simply profits actually become more competitive.
So, you know, that's, I need you to tell me a story from one of your, in one of your book chapters, like, because the fact that you are talking to patients, individuals, and to corporations about this is mind-blowing. And I'm actually, it's delightful to hear that people are willing to make that change, especially at the level of the corporations. So please share a story for us.
I'll tell you the story in my own organization where, and this is Novant Health. We're a very large multi-state organization with nearly 40,000 employees. And I spend a half of my time as a cardiologist and half of my time on what's called the Office for Well-Being. And we look after all the job families the nurses, the doctors, the APPs, the executives. And we design dozens of programs, but also we bring together all of the individuals in the organization who are focused on organizational reform and operational improvement, whether it's the EHR team, who's now bringing AI into the exam room to offload some of the clerical duties, whether it's the head of nursing, who is trying to help with staffing ratios, et cetera. We combine that with intensive coaching. So for a dozen years, our institution has taken every month a group of 20 leaders across all divisions offsite for 3 days and helped them with intensive coaching about their own self-awareness to help them come back to the workplace with a new sense of purpose, of intention, of connection and commitment. And we've seen a dramatic improvement in levels of stress and levels of burnout from that by taking that approach where we focus both on the organizational problems that need to be fixed, but also on the individual problems where we can upskill and give some coaching and leadership training to physicians and nurses where they've never gotten it often. They've just pushed into the position. And we take people who are on the edge of burnout and we help them make the right decision. Now, sometimes that decision is to leave the organization, and that's okay. And sometimes it's to leave medicine. And sometimes it's to stay in the organization and become committed to making the changes that they were used to be complaining about. Now they have the skills to work with others and the emotional intelligence to actually advocate and enact the change.
Fantastic. That's amazing. And honestly, kudos to you for doing this and kind of helping the healers, right? Sometimes the healers get forgotten and healing is needed for the healers as well. So I really am so glad there are more people like you coming out and talking about this and making this happen for us. Now, as an individual on a patient, on, I won't even call this as a patient, but as a person who is, you know, working, trying to get a promotion, trying to get ahead in life, make ends meet, who's ambitious, how can they incorporate mindfulness practice, or how can they even understand that they need it and do it preemptively, not wait for a burnout to happen, or how do they prevent getting into that deep vicious circle of burnout?
I think the first question to ask is, am I happy in my life right now?
Oh, that's a loaded question. I don't think I can answer that question.
It's a loaded question, and just like stepping on the scale in the morning. So it's a loaded question to step on the scale for some people. I don't want to see what my weight is today. I'm going to feel guilty. I'm going to feel ashamed. I better not look. Well, then what happens? We never begin the hard work of, as you were saying before, being with the discomfort and learning how to loosen some of our judgment about ourselves. And the same thing applies. The same thing applies with, before we jump into mindfulness, we simply have to ask the people we're with, that we're coaching or ourselves, is, am I thriving in my life right now? If I'm being fully honest, can I let go of any judgment? If the answer is no, can I just accept and be kind to myself and say, this is a season in my life where I'm not thriving, and frankly, if I'm being honest, I'm not happy. Because until we can fully accept the reality of our situation now, we're going to continue to try to escape and numb ourselves out with all of the behaviors that are leading us, we think in the short term towards comfort, but in the long term, much farther away from thriving and fulfillment. And that's where I begin, which is a simple self-inquiry. With compassion. And then if people want to know one of the many tools of how do we get out of this place of stuckness and self-judgment, one of the most powerful tools, and this is now based on thousands of research papers and peer-reviewed articles, not just in the mental health research, but in the cardiovascular research, the American Heart Association wrote a white paper in 2017 showing that mindfulness practice is a useful adjunctive practice for all of our patients at reducing cardiovascular risk. So we no longer can say that this is something that's mystical for people who want to float on a cushion and wear special robes and chant in a different language. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about training our minds to function more optimally in a more healthy way so that our behaviors and our interactions can improve.
Everything you say just resonates with me so well. It's amazing. Yes, accepting a problem, and as you said, it might be a temporary situation. Right now, I'm doing 5 different things, and I'm extremely busy. And I had to, if I have to mentally ask myself, am I thriving right now? Yes, I'm thriving, but it's really hard to thrive. It's a lot of work and effort making me thrive. And honestly, one of the tools for me, which helps me deal with that, is my meditation, my Calm mindfulness app. I'm not getting any endorsements from any of this, but it's personally helped me. And I literally, I tell my patients, I have to go before a big case. I will find a call room or sometimes a restroom, sit there for 5 minutes, and that just shifts my brain so much and reduces my stress level unbelievably. And I think I can see a visible change in myself when I do it. So yes, I think.
Arasi, I'm curious because I have my own answer and I have a similar practice when I'm on call. I find an empty room in the cath lab and I sit for 5 or 10 minutes until the pager goes off. What do you think it is about that practice that helps you get back to a place where you really show up in your best way in the cath lab or for your patients?
For me, I think it's decision fatigue. You're constantly making millions of decisions, right? Like as you said in the cath lab, I'm not just responsible for teaching my physician and making sure my staff don't screw up. I'm looking at the monitor, I'm looking at the EKGs, and somewhere at the back of the mind, they're saying, hey, ACT is XYZ number, and I'm calculating a heparin dose for them. At the same time, my hands are moving the wires. I'm also in tune with the patient symptoms. My patients are not under general anesthesia. If they yawn, or if they suddenly start coughing, or even if they pass a gas, I know something is wrong. So you're in a state of heightened awareness in the cath lab. And then when you're rounding also, there are so many cues you get by talking to a patient, seeing a patient, but there are these nonverbal cues also. So you are you're watching everything and observing everything and making judgments in your head and making decisions in your head. So for me, that 5 minutes or sometimes even 2 minutes of not making any decisions and just be here. It just reduces my cortisol level like crazy.
Yeah, this ties very nicely into a field that's taking more prominence in the workplace, which is called human ergonomics, which is a recognition that some of burnout isn't moral injury, for example. It's simply the cognitive overload that the human mind was never meant to face. And so the practice of mindfulness, as you describe it, is very similar for me, where I notice that the wheels of my mind are spinning so fast, and the practice for me is just allowing them to slow down without continuing to race the wheel by adding thoughts of, oh, but I'm worried about this, and I'm worried about that, and what about this? It's allowing the mind to slow down, and eventually, I have this beautiful snow globe here. And for me, the reason I keep this on my desk is because I spent 20 years as a cardiologist running around, and this was my mind. All these questions and thoughts and decisions, and it never, ever, ever settled down. And my body was therefore very, very tense, and I couldn't even see past my own thoughts. And so the practice of mindfulness for me eventually started with 1 minute, and then 5, and then 10, and then for a whole week sitting in a silent retreat at a Zen monastery. And we see that there are different levels of settling. And once we experience that real deep calm and settling that some people think is our natural state, we realize that we can tap into that in any moment. And we get stronger and stronger at the ability to switch like that and to cause everything to settle.
I have experienced it, even though I haven't, when I'm in the cath lab and suddenly there's an EKG change or something like that, and I can feel the switch happening inside me almost, and I'm I can hear my own breathing, and that's when I'm quietening everything down, and the decision just, I know it sounds a little woo-woo, but it pops in my head. I'm like, and I don't know, it changes your personality for sure. And I always tell anyone who knows me, I tell them, cath lab is my zone. Like, you know, I'm everywhere and every input is going through me and every output is coming through me. It's like my perfect place. And then, and the mindfulness has truly helped me perform better. It is like how you say in your book, it has expanded my resilience to a lot. So yes, I cannot recommend mindfulness. But you know, you started this conversation about, in the beginning, you said how you lost a patient and you were thinking about that. And similar things happen to all of us. You know, we lose a patient, I carry it for a long time, and I'm training myself to get better, but it may not be related to losing a patient, but even losing a project, performing badly on a meeting. What are your tips for managing what we perceive as a loss?
Yeah, it's a beautiful question. And you use the word perceive as a loss. And so there's only three levers that we can pull or that we can work on when it comes to how we are perceiving something or experiencing something that's painful, whether it's a bad experience or something that we experienced as bad. You know, Shakespeare said, there's nothing good or bad, but thinking makes it so. And the Stoic philosophers from 3,000 years ago said the very same thing. This is basically all they said, which is that nothing in life is good or bad. There's human perception, which then colors the experience. But ultimately, and this is also a Buddhist and a Zen principle too, is that you might think a story has a bad ending, but then look further and you see that it was actually the beginning of something wonderful. And the way that I think about it is there's three levers. One, and these three levels are our attention, so what we pay attention to when we have a loss or something. Number two is our perception, so what are we noticing when we're shifting our attention? And three is how we appraise a situation. What meaning do we make? How do we interpret it? So there's the information, and what are we focusing on? So on the first hand, if something devastating happens, let's say somebody threatens us with a lawsuit, and it's all I can think about, all the time I'm thinking about that. Well, of course, that's going to keep my body in a state of activation, sympathetic overdrive. And you alluded to this in the cath lab when your decisions improved. But what we now know in neuroscience is that when the sympathetic nervous system becomes active and there's some perceived crisis, our prefrontal cortex, the executive center, goes offline. And we lose our capacity to think deep into the future and to see in a 360 view, and our ability to make wise decisions decreases, and our ability to think creatively decreases. So we become very present oriented and fear oriented. So the first is, what are we paying attention to? Even in moments of stress, we have to forcefully, essentially take back control of our attention and instead look at something that brings us joy, brings us a sense of love. Like, Maybe our child, maybe our loved one, maybe a good friend, maybe a piece of music or a poetry. In a sense, to keep training our attention, even though it's sticky, this other hard thing. Number one is attention. Two is perception. Something can be right in front of us, Arasi, and we don't even see it. So I can be, if I'm driving to work and I'm thinking about this lawsuit, I could be passing by, even though they're there, all of these beautiful trees, beautiful flowers, beautiful sky, and I won't even notice it. So it's about training ourselves to be more perceptive to the things that really lift us up and not just bring us down. And the third, which is the one that most people can understand most intuitively, is the meaning that we make. So if you have a lawsuit or something bad happen, you could right away say, this is the end of my life. This is the end of my career. This is the end of my reputation. I'm the worst person in the world. Now, you can either choose to believe those thoughts, or you can do something radical, which is the beginning of all happiness, which is to say, huh, those are just thoughts that came from my mind. And maybe there are other thoughts which are more true, which are more accurate. And so this practice, what's called cognitive reframing or cognitive restructuring, which comes from the science-based field of cognitive behavioral therapy, which is very, very helpful. And I write all about that in the book as well, about how exactly to do that.
Fantastic. I mean, you know, spot on, seriously spot on. Now, you talk about, there's a phrase you mention in your book, and I connection heals, isolation harms. Talk about that, please.
Initial emotion researchers described first three basic emotions, and then five, and then 10. And now, depending on who you look at, there are dozens of emotions and emotional states. But as a cardiologist who's also studied the mind-heart connection, the physiologic pathways, there really are only two categories of emotions or emotional states. There are those that cause us to contract within ourselves, to shut ourselves off to the future, to other people, to creative thinking, to empathy, compassion, and love. And then, and for example, those would be anger, hostility, PTSD, fear, loneliness, you name it. And the second broad category of emotions, some people call them positive emotions. I don't love that word, and I describe why, because once we start to judge emotions as good or bad, rather than simply information, we create a secondary cycle of reaction to the emotion itself. So the second category of emotions are those that cause us to expand, not only physiologically, they can lower our blood pressure, slow our heart rate, respiratory rate, dilate our pupils, reduce gastric acid production, but also shift brain function. And these fall into the category of generosity. These are what I call the heart wakers in the book, in chapter four. The generosity, compassion, empathy, love, etc. And what's happening here, if we talk about why loneliness harms and why love heals, there are very clear physiologic pathways. And there's a whole new area of science in the last two decades called psychoneuroimmunology, PNI. And this is not mystical. This is not woo-woo. It basically says that our emotional state, whether we're feeling safe or threatened, determines our immune system's readiness for some either threat or connection. And there are two very discrete physiological states that are associated either with the typical person who is either a narcissist or is hostile to everyone. They are revved up and they have more inflammation in their body. They may have some suppression of their immune system, and their perception is relatively closed, so they don't see the needs of other people clearly. And this has been studied now, that narcissists, basically, they're self-centered and they are not empathic as much as other people. And the flip side of that is when we experience love, we have activation of the parasympathetic nervous system. The oxytocin, which is originated so that a mother can nurse a child. But that same pathway is also the root of romantic love and connection. And it's also the root of doctor-patient connection. And it's also the root of your and my connection. So if we're in a state of connection, empathy, friendship, love, we're both starting to co-regulate. There's a synchronization of our cardiovascular pathways, and this has been studied now, where our heart rates both move in unison. They slow down. Our heart rate variability starts to synchronize to some degree. And this is important, not just in one-on-one relationships, but if we're going to change the way we lead others in healthcare and in other industries, leaders have to start taking responsibility for the physiological changes, not only in their own bodies, with the way that they speak and present themselves, but on the subconscious impact they are having on the immune system function and the cardiovascular system and health of the people around them. And so this is part of the message as well, making what it was previously invisible more visible so people realize the impact of our emotional state.
Fantastic. Another statement which really connected with me was heart-centered living connects us to what matters most, and you call love, compassion, and purpose. I loved that term, heart-centered living. Can you expand on that?
If we look at the rise of Western Enlightenment, beginning in the 1500s and 1600s, and then moving to the Industrial Revolution, 1700s, 1800s in Europe, there has been a common trend, and I discuss the history of the evolution of the meaning of the heart versus the meaning of the mind in Western society, and the trend has been a shift from the intuition and wisdom of the heart, from all of the world's traditions, towards a predominance of cognitive function and the hierarchy where the brain now is dominant above the heart. And heart-centered leadership, heart-centered living is a simple recalibration. It's a recognition that when we are overly dependent on the rational parts of the brain, often located in the left frontal cortex, we tend to ignore those parts of the wisdom that we talked about earlier that allow us to tap into what I believe is our most important skill as healers, which is empathy. Empathy, which leads to compassion and love. And so there's been a historical trend away from the heart towards the mind. And this is partly to blame René Descartes, 1600s French philosopher and famous mathematician, who had this idea that I think, therefore I am. And so many people took that and ran with it in a way that said, well, if I want to show my power in the world, then what do I need to do? I simply need to think. And there's been a diminution, a reduction in the importance of emotions. And I think that there's now a return to that. And I think the pendulum is swinging back. There's going to be some adjustments that are made as we're all finding a way to talk about emotions where we don't overdo it, and we talk about them in a healthy way, and everything doesn't become a trauma, let's say. And at the same time, I think overall we're in a healthier place than when before we focused only on people who were thinking and smart intellectually.
I love this recalibration. And I mean, I think you are absolutely right. We need to pay more attention to the heart and find happiness within where we are instead of using our brain to keep hammering, like, you know, almost acting like Hulk and smashing around everything and making too much noise. So, Dr. Fisher, we have spoken so much. We've touched so many topics. I want you to tell us, how does your practice look like? Not your cardiology practice, but your mindfulness practice. How do you find time or insert it throughout your day?
There are many practices that I actively do throughout my day. The most important practice was a shift in my attitude and my priorities, which happened many years ago. And it's why I went from a doctor who was completely burned out and ready to leave to someone who loves going into my clinic and has amazing relationships with 35 staff members, with hugs and high fives and smiles. And my patients won't let me leave without a hug and a kiss after we talk about their medications. And this is not because a healthcare system changed already. It didn't. This is something that changed inside of me. And before even mindfulness, it was a shift in my priority. And my priority shifted back towards, how can I connect more deeply and more lovingly and more caringly with myself? And how can I then use that as an example about how I want to relate to other people? And shifting and making this new priority, human relationships and human connections, above everything I spent my whole life working towards, which was getting into Harvard and being the top of my class and working harder than everyone else. That worked to a certain point, but it also led me a little bit in the wrong direction. So before coming to mindfulness, I would encourage, if someone's listening and they're wondering, sometimes it's just simply shifting the focus from how much more can I do in my day to how can I be someone that shows up with more love for him or herself and for those around them. Everything changes when you make that one small change.
I think that, as you said earlier, it's going to take a deep and long look in the mirror and asking that question you mentioned in here, are you happy? And kind of based on that answer, reframing everything else. Dr. Fisher, thank you so much for joining us. And I'm going to end with a quote. The heart is more than a pump. It is the seat of our deepest emotions. And we should, as you have recommended in so many different ways, take good care of it and heal it from within. So, Dr. Fisher, thank you so much for joining me today.
What a pleasure. What a pleasure. Keep doing all of your wonderful work. And I hope to see you in South Carolina one of these days.